tragic accident, but authorities charged Dominic Murray with second-degree child cruelty, a felony.
Now we're looking into how these charges came about, and we're learning more about the type of mother Murray is. Alyssa Lyon spoke to a defense attorney today about Murray's mother. She's live in the studio with that.
Now, if convicted, Murray faces between 1 and 10 years behind bars, all for something the incident report calls accidental.
And I was like, no, no, no. My baby.
Her grandbaby gone, her daughter behind bars.
A good young lady. Somebody who's not of the streets. And not in the streets. She take care of her kids. She take care of her home.
Dominique wasn't even allowed to say goodbye to 2-year-old Justice. She was in jail when he died last night at the hospital.
They could have brought her up there with her chains covered up. Justin needed to see and hear his mother's voice. And they deprived her from that. They took that away from her.
We called the jail to ask why that didn't happen.
Heard that she was not allowed to be released to see her son pass. Is there a reason why that happened as well?
Jail staff told us they have to get approval. If it doesn't get approval through the ranks, they cannot attend. We reached out to the sheriff's office to ask who grants that approval. The sheriff's office said they will not be making any statements due to it being an active investigation. Family tells us the baby's doctor requested the mother be able to come to the hospital since his time was limited, but he died before that ever happened. Now Murray faces child cruelty in the second degree, but those charges could change now that the child has died.
It could definitely be upgraded in a case of this nature. It's really going to have to do with prosecutorial discretion. Anytime you have a death and a child is involved because of some type of a felony, like cruelty to children in the second, well, then the charge could either be felony murder or murder in the second degree, which is a death that occurs as a result of cruelty to children.
It's in the prosecutor's hands.
There's always the opportunity for, you know, negotiations. Once the investigation is conducted and a prosecutor gets to look at the case, it really is going to be depending on how negligent the actions were. There's a lot, big difference in a child wandering away for 2 minutes and falling in a pool and a child that has been left unsupervised, unattended for an hour.
As for the family, they say,
you can always do the right thing. When this was not done right,
I also asked the detention center whether Murray has a chance of being released on bond. In our initial appearance, they said her bond needs to be addressed by a superior court judge. For now, she does not have a bond set.
Just tragedy all the way around. Alyssa, thank you for the story there. As we give you a live look outside, and voters cast a ballot, totaling 1,026 people in 2018. Only 688 people voted on the second day of early voting. And early voting lasts until the 4th of November.
Coming up, nonprofits were hit hard during the pandemic. Now a program donating beds to kids is making a comeback. How you can get involved coming up.
Well, late tonight and early tomorrow morning, we are expecting temperatures close to freezing. We'll take a look at some freeze warnings and frost advisories just after the break. The weekend forecast is going to be great for us. We're going to hang on to plenty of sunshine for the rest of the week. Those temperatures will be much more seasonal Saturday and Sunday and gradually just get a little bit warmer by early next week.
Riley, thanks. The pandemic put a lot of things on hold, not just for businesses and families, but for nonprofits as well. One of those programs was A Place to Dream through the Family Y that provides beds to children in need.
Before the pandemic, they were installing about 30 to 40 beds a month for kids in our area. Kids went from sleeping on the floor or couches or sharing a twin mattress with their siblings to a comfortable space of their own. They've started this program back up, but they can only provide beds on an emergency basis right now, and there's a wait list. We went along for a delivery to see what difference this program can make for families here at home and how you can help kids have a place to dream.
Say hey. Say hi, Felicity. Say hi.
Felicia Favero is a single mom to 4 kids. Her youngest just got out of the hospital.
I just had a new baby. His name is Uzziah. He's about to be 3 weeks old on Saturday.
inflation and now caring for a special needs child have been hard for Felicia would be an understatement. She's grateful to have a roof over their heads and food in their mouths, but there isn't a lot beyond that.
I wasn't able to provide good beds for them, being a single mom.
So when her landlord told her to apply for beds through A Place to Dream, she did, and got a call 2 days later that gave her some hope.
Excited, I cried. I'm excited for my children to have some good beds.
A team of volunteers from the Family Y brought 3 beds in a crib paid for out of the pockets of complete strangers, wanting nothing in return but a chance for Felicia's family to have the chance to dream.
We've got a wait list currently, and so right now we're really just trying to raise the funds and get the volunteers that can help us get these beds out to these kids who need them.
So far, in our area alone, since 2017, the Family Y has donated nearly 1,400 beds for kids. And the applications for help haven't stopped. They've only stacked up during the pandemic.
And we truly feel like it's a huge need for a child to have a bed, because I don't know how we can expect them to get up every morning, go to school, learn, and without having a proper, safe, comfortable place to go to sleep and dream every night.
Now that her children have a place to dream, Felicia has a dream of her own.
To make sure that my kids are successful in life, and to make sure, and I hope and dream that my son will be able to walk when he gets older.
With a safe place to sleep, he's one step closer to that first step.
It's one of those great local programs that you may have never heard of.
Right.
So how can people help?
Well, there's a lot of ways. Volunteering to put the beds together, they need physical labor, and also giving financially. And Christmas is coming up. I love this season and this idea for somebody. If you have that impossible buy for aunt or uncle, $200 buys a complete bed. That includes the twin bed frame, the mattress, the linens, the pillow, the Bible, a stuffed animal. So instead of getting them a sweater they're never going to wear, donate $200 and tell them you got a child a place to sleep every night.
In their name.
That'll do some good mileage.
And what a difference it makes for those families.
Yes,
and
we're going to put all the info on our website with how to do that, how to donate, how to volunteer, WRDW.com.
We're back with more in a moment.
The live by camera.
Nothing. Luckily for them, the Super Regionals are double elimination, so Grovetown is still alive, but one more loss means that their season comes to an end.
Thank you, Dan. Republicans in the South Carolina State House say they now face a stiff challenge to pass tighter abortion restrictions by the end of the year.
But their window of opportunity isn't completely closed yet. State House reporter Mary Green joins us in Columbia, where yet another debate today ended with lawmakers in a stalemate over the bill. Mary, what happened? Well, Laura, Richard, what you need to know is the House of Representatives and the Senate have passed two different abortion bills. Today, the Senate refused to agree with the House's bill and send it to the governor. After last month, the House refused to do the same with the Senate's bill. So now it's up to a smaller committee of members from both chambers to try to work out some sort of compromise between these two bills. And they've got less than a month to do it.
A vote of 38-6, the Senate insists on Senate amendments.
That vote means South Carolina lawmakers remain at a stalemate. Republicans push to further restrict abortion law following the overturn of Roe v. Wade. Right now, South Carolina's current law amounts to a ban on abortion after around 6 weeks. But the state Supreme Court has temporarily blocked it from being enforced, with a hearing on that legal challenge scheduled for Wednesday. The bill the state Senate passed this summer adjusts that 6-week ban, including clearing up the language in the law that led the Supreme Court to block it. Senate Republicans say they don't have enough support to pass an abortion ban from conception. That's what the House passed, including limited exceptions for the mother's life and health and for victims of sexual assault. Now neither chamber will agree to the other's bill, including the Senate voting Tuesday to stick with its bill instead of approving what's called a motion to recede.
I'm very disappointed in today's vote. The vote to recede would have sent the House bill to the governor's desk. It was the kind of bill that almost all those Republicans who voted against the motion to recede actually said they support.
We need to make sure that our privacy rights are protected and to make sure that government stays out of the medical office room with her doctor. I want to make sure that women are protected and children are protected.
So again, it's now up to that smaller group of legislators, 3 from the Senate and 3 from the House, to try to work out a compromise between those have until November 13th to get a compromise, if they're able to come to one, to the governor's desk, or else the state legislature would have to wait until next year to try to pass tighter abortion restrictions here in South Carolina. Reporting live from South Carolina State House, Mary Green on your side.
All right, thanks, Mary. Senators from both parties were in agreement today that no matter what happens in the next month, there will certainly be pushes at the state house next year to try to pass a ban on abortion.
Well, it's going to stay chilly for the rest of the work week, but luckily for any weekend plans, our temperatures warm back up into the 70s each afternoon. Now look at that 7-day forecast just after break.